So I really want to take a moment to talk about Joe Biden and just really urge anyone, if you're watching this and you know Joe Biden, maybe just check in on him, make sure he's doing okay, because we keep seeing these weird outbursts from Joe Biden. You know, a couple of weeks ago, he had his why moment with the reporter, and now we have this where he calls someone. Just watch.
Hi, my name is Madison, and I'm an econ student at Mercer University. And, oh, awesome. So I'm going to be a little bit mean for a second, okay? So, so you're arguably the candidate with the greatest advantage in this race. You've been the vice president. You weren't burdened down by the impeachment trials. So, in the participation. So how do you explain the performance in Iowa, and why should the voters believe that you can win the national election?
It's a good question. Number one, Iowa's a Democratic caucus. You ever been to a caucus? No, you haven't. You're a lying dog-faced pony soldier. You said you were, but now you got to be honest. I'm going to be honest with you.
He called her a lying, dog-faced pony soldier. Anyone? I don't know, guys. I don't know. What do you even say to that? You're a lying, dog-faced pony soldier. What the fuck? And look, he tried to be a good sport because she asked him a pretty tough question, and it probably made him feel a little bit insecure about his chances, and he really should be worried right now. I would be worried if I was on Team Biden currently. Thank God I'm not. And he lashed out, seemingly, and called her a lying dog-faced pony soldier. Okay. Interesting. Now, before I comment further on this, the girl who was called a long dog-faced pony soldier was interviewed by Fox News. She's only 21 years old, and this is what she had to say in response.
Campaign says that Joe Biden's actually used the line before, but it doesn't make it any more relatable to a 21-year-old college student from Mercer University named Madison Moore. She had asked the vice president how he planned to compete nationally after such a poor showing in Iowa. Here was her response.
A lot of what he's saying seems to be really pathos-based and very sad. We have heard a lot about deaths and cancer and people losing their jobs. And to me, he doesn't really seem very solution-oriented. And I don't think he has the momentum to carry this to a national election.
Yeah, so he's not talking much about policy. And, quote, I don't think he has enough momentum to carry this to a national election. Exactly. Exactly. Like, maybe people are starting to realize that if you see no momentum for a campaign, then the writing is on the wall. I mean, the same thing was there with Hillary Clinton back in 2015 and 2016. She would have, like, trouble filling up school gymnasiums. Like, there was no momentum there for her, right? And you saw these huge crowds with thousands and thousands of people, you know, lining up to see Bernie Sanders. And the same thing is happening with Joe Biden. But, you know, name recognition, just this perceived electability, it carried him to this point. But, you know, when push comes to shove, voters in Iowa showed that he's not doing too well. And worse yet, you know, I don't think he's expecting to perform very well in New Hampshire. I don't think he believes he will win. It's probably going to come down to Bernie Sanders and Pete Buttigieg. But there are some polls showing that Joe Biden may even perform worse than Amy Klobuchar. Like, he's polling in fifth place. Now, if he performs in fourth place in Iowa and fifth place in New Hampshire, will he even be able to make it to South Carolina? Because he's kind of betting everything on South Carolina, because that's the state where he's had a gargantuan lead throughout this process. And Hillary Clinton beat Bernie Sanders pretty badly in South Carolina back in 2016. So he's hanging on for dear life, hoping that he can win South Carolina so people will believe that he's still viable. But now you see this, you know, surge of Tom Steyer out of nowhere in South Carolina. Bernie Sanders is in third place. I'm hoping that he'll outperform the polls. Regardless, that's basically what is keeping Joe Biden's campaign going. Just this thought that if we can make it to South Carolina, maybe we'll have a little bit of momentum going into Super Tuesday. But the problem is that, you know, the South Carolina primary takes place, and then just days later, we have Super Tuesday. So, I mean, if you're going to get that bump, you at least want, I'm assuming, you know, a week worth of news coverage that shows, oh, well, maybe Joe Biden is still in this. So that way that narrative can kind of, you know, spread and people can kind of internalize it and realize, okay, maybe he's not out yet. But I mean, if he finishes in fifth place in New Hampshire, we'll find out tomorrow, hopefully, assuming everything goes well. Man, I don't know that he'll be able to make it. And you can kind of see it on his face that he realizes this is the end of the road. And, like, nobody believes, I don't think even Joe Biden believes he wants to do this right now. I think he wants to retire, but he probably felt like this was going to be an easy primary race. You're the former vice president, you jump in, you have the most name recognition, and you just beat everyone else. Except that's not happening. And rather than just choosing to sit this one out, he's kind of tarnishing his legacy. He's hurting his legacy. Because, you know, if he just chose to retire after being vice president, everyone would have remembered him fondly as Obama's vice president, the first African-American president's VP. But he jumped in, immediately got Me Too'd by four women who accused him of touching him inappropriately, which was obvious to everyone, but it wasn't discussed at a national level. His entire record, you know, a racist record, the crime bill, him praising segregationists, was exposed, and his legacy was tarnished because of this primary, and he knew it would be brutal, but nonetheless, like a lot of elites, he was just so arrogant and felt entitled to the primary when he's not reading the room. Like, it's a different era in American politics. And after 8 years of him being in power, not many people feel as if their lives have changed for the better. And if they have, maybe not enough. So it's just, it wasn't his time. And really, he's ran multiple primary campaigns before and lost every time. It was Obama who carried him across the finish line. So you kind of see, like, it's almost sad in a way, like you see it in his face, like he knows the end is near, and you see that reaction, the, you know, the outbursts, the why, the lying dog-faced pony soldier, you see it, and in a way, it really is sad, like just from a human level. Like, I don't like Joe Biden, his policies are absolute garbage. Overall, his career is just, I mean, how do you characterize it? His record is atrocious. He voted for a war that killed possibly a million people, hundreds of thousands at a minimum. So, you know, we wouldn't be talking about that if he just chose to stay home. We'd just remember him as Obama's VP. But he jumped in, and he tarnished his legacy, and now he's probably going to lose. That's tough. And we're kind of seeing him grapple with this in real time as he has these types of outbursts.
Alpha male, not a beta male.